So much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. When there's despair in life, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, only light. And where the sadness ever joy. Oh, Master, grant that I may never see so much to be consoled as to console. To be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. It isn't pardoning that we are pardoned, in giving to all men that we receive, and in dying that we're born to each other. Piece I'm going to do is actually a prayer. It's called The Prayer for Total Freedom, and it was written by L. Ron Hubbard. May the author of the universe enable all men to reach an understanding of their spiritual nature. Understanding of life expand so that all may come to know the author of the universe. And may others also reach this understanding which brings total freedom, brings total freedom. At this time we think of those whose liberty is threatened, of those who have suffered imprisonment for their beliefs, for those who are enslaved or martyred, and for all those who are brutalized, trapped or attacked. We pray that human rights will be preserved so that all people may be seen in our land. Freedom from war and poverty and want, freedom to be, freedom to do, and freedom to have. Freedom to use and understand man's potential, a potential that is God-given and God-like. Freedom to achieve that understanding and awareness that is total freedom. One more song. This is a medieval song. I got it from the TV series Camelot. And if the soul howls through the wall, and if the skies should cloud to darkness, I'll be your song, I'll be your song.
planting the sets of these cranes as gifts, each holding 1,000 paper cranes. Tonight, we would like to honor our guest speakers with a set of cranes, and we ask that they display it in a public place to remind us all of the importance of peace in our lives. Ms. Glasser? Before you go, in appreciation of your performance today, I would like to present you with this set of paper cranes and ask you to display it in a public place if possible. Thank you. Our next performance will be the fabulous Yokudo Traditional Japanese Drummers. The Yokudo Drummers were founded in 1992 as a non-profit organization made up of passionate individuals dedicated to the culture and art unique to the Japanese taiko. Taiko are traditional Japanese drums used historically to summon spirits for fortune, strength, and harmony. Their powerful sounds are rumored to shake the earth and heavens above. The mighty, thunderous sound, yet much like the sound of a mother's heartbeat to her child. It can be rhythmically soothing. I now present the Yokudo Traditional Japanese Drummers. Thank you. by the Yakudo traditional Japanese drummers, always a moving addition to the Hiroshima Day coalition events. And of note, they have been coming out year after year to support this event on August 6th or August 9th. So in appreciation, I would like to give you a set of 1,000 paper cranes from Hiroshima. That is for you. Hopefully you can take it with you when you travel and play and remind everybody about the importance of peace in our lives and for the planet. Thank you very much. My name is Vinay Jindal, and as the chair of the Hiroshima Day Coalition, I welcome you to From Despair to Hope, Preventing Catastrophic Harm. This is Toronto's commemoration ceremony for the 69th anniversary of the bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Now, I'm a family physician, and I work in Scarborough. I deal a lot about prevention every day. Preventive medicine, trying to prevent stroke and heart attack, disease and illness, before it happens. I give a lot of advice too, every day. And sometimes, people actually listen. But the ultimate in prevention is preventing a nuclear war. And the only way to ensure a nuclear war never happens is to abolish all nuclear weapons. So today, we remember the tragedy. We remember those who died and those who survived. And we aspire to eliminate nuclear weapons. The Hiroshima Day Coalition includes representatives of community and peace groups and concerned individuals from across the GTA. The coalition formed to commemorate the atomic bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki and to work for the abolition of nuclear weapons. To ensure the human suffering and destruction inflicted by the first atomic bombings of 1945 will never be repeated, the Hiroshima Day Coalition plans all year for these August events. Today we have 9 countries with nuclear weapons, with about 17,000 nuclear bombs on this planet. And each of today's bombs are 50 to 100 times more powerful than those first bombs that dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. But there is new hope. The Humanitarian Consequences of Nuclear Weapons Conferences started in 2013 in Oslo, and they continued in Nayarit, Mexico this year, and will reach in December, they will reach Vienna. Governments, the United Nations, and civil society come together to discuss how to achieve nuclear disarmament. Surprisingly, or not surprisingly, the nuclear weapons states are denouncing these conferences. They're refusing to attend. But the process of nuclear abolition is pushing forward, with or without their permission. Also, there are the Marshall Islands. This small nation of islands in the Pacific was evacuated after World War II. Why? To test nuclear weapons. Their country was devastated by approximately 70 nuclear blasts over a period of 12 years, and the people and the environment suffer because of it. The Marshall Islands, they are taking the 9 nuclear weapon states to the International Court of Justice for breach of contract. That is the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, Article 6, for failing to pursue negotiations for disarmament in good faith, and for modernizing their nuclear arsenal. But they are not looking for a settlement. What they are looking for is a commitment to complete nuclear disarmament, a global zero. Yes, very good. And actually, for this, the Marshall Islands will be awarded the McBride Peace Prize by the International Peace Bureau at the coming conference in Vienna. So the despair that the peace movement has felt is giving way to hope. The international campaign to abolish nuclear weapons continues in its path for a nuclear weapons convention, a treaty to lead to abolition, following the path of the successful Landmines Treaty. So on this solemn occasion of marking the loss of hundreds of thousands of lives and the tragedy nuclear weapons have brought to this planet, today, we have hope. hope for a world free of nuclear weapons. And now I would like to take the opportunity to introduce some members of the Toronto Area Interfaith Council. The TAIC is an organization of representatives of faith communities and groups. It is dedicated to affirming the importance of ethics, spirituality, and faith in daily life, and the promotion of understanding, harmony, respect, and acceptance. Zul Kasimali is the president of the Toronto Area Interfaith Council and vice president of the Association of Progressive Muslims in Canada. Reverend Earl Smith is an executive of the TAIC, representative to the Hiroshima Day Coalition, and is interfaith coordinator for the Church of Scientology in Toronto. I invite them to make a statement on behalf of the TAIC and to perform an opening prayer. Mr. Kasimali and Reverend Smith.
Thank you, Rene. Ladies and gentlemen, I am delighted to be invited to speak today, and I will make few remarks. But before I do that, I just want to applaud, we as Canadians, we talk too much, very little action, but at least we are trying. And having said that, I tell you, there is so much work to be done. And I think everybody is listening to the news today, what is happening in British Columbia. And when we talk about prevention, no prevention from the beginning, but now they will pour millions of dollars for this disaster. So I think we have to shape up and really speak out and be united in what we want to achieve. We are here on this Hiroshima Day Coalition with befitting theme, From Despair to Hope, Preventing Catastrophic Harm. We know that currently approximately 17,000 nuclear bombs exist. Hiroshima was a man-made disaster that had consequences of unimaginable proportions. Unlike natural disasters, we have under our control these nuclear bombs, whether to launch or not to launch. The nuclear bomb has been manufactured with the best scientific minds and intellectual capacity, with only one outcome: to be only used as weapons of mass destruction. I am here not to judge or provide context as why these were deployed in the past, but it rests on all our shoulders to find a solution to diffusing any tension proactively and actively that may cause such disasters. Furthermore, God has created our minds and intellect not for the purposes that can cause harm to others. Additionally, I am here to appeal to all of you to join me on this Hiroshima Coalition Day to do our part to keep the world better than what we found. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Zul. Again, on behalf of the Toronto Area Interfaith Council, I want to welcome you and thank you for coming to remember the tragedy of the nuclear disaster in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, but also so we can come together to do something about it. Now, we all pray and meditate, perhaps each in our own way and each in our own faith tradition, so please feel free to do so. So, let us pray. Let us pray to the Creator, of our own faith traditions. O Creator of all, we pray to you today for guidance in keeping our planet safe from nuclear war and all forms of war. We pray that we will not repeat the past destruction of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and that our political leaders will recognize the absolute necessity to ban all nuclear weapons now and in the future. Give us the courage not to fear or to despair or to be apathetic about nuclear warfare and its abolition, but to face the challenges of today's world with effective actions. Heal the hearts and minds of those affected by nuclear warfare, themselves or those who have lost loved ones to the cruelty of nuclear disasters. Help us end the suffering, violence, and war in all parts of the world. Guide us in being loving to one another and not giving in to hatred, for to love is the road to strength, and to hate alone, the road to disaster. Help us create a world where we can all live in peace and harmony with each other, and where we respect and love one another, whatever our race, color, or creed. Let us not stray from our resolve for peace, and help us to stay the course. Help keep us on the path of godliness, peace, and love. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Casamali and Reverend Smith. Once again, some gifts from Hiroshima, 1,000 paper cranes. Please display it to remind your congregations, your Toronto Area Interfaith Council, about the great importance of peace in our lives. Thank you. Mayors for Peace is an international movement of mayors representing their citizens with the goal to abolish nuclear weapons. Since 1983, Toronto's mayor has been a Mayors for Peace. And we are very pleased to have several of Toronto's 2014 mayoral candidates with us today. Many have provided statements on what they would do as a Mayor for Peace. And we have quotes in your program today. If you haven't picked up a program, it is at the Hiroshima Day Coalition table right on the right side here. If you would like to see their full statement, it is posted on our HiroshimaDayCoalition.ca website. I would like to acknowledge the mayoral candidates that are here today, and we have a gift for the mayoral candidates. It is a book called From Hiroshima to Fukushima to You, a primer on radiation and health. And this is being donated by Physicians for Global Survival, an international organization of physicians dealing with the elimination of nuclear weapons. So what I will do is call the mayor's names one by one, and if you can just come up stage on stage for a second, I'll present you with your gift. Jeff Billard. Olivia Chow. DeWitt Lee. Erwin Snydzen. David Soknaki. Karen Stintz. Himi Said.
Nagasaki Day in the city of Toronto. I encourage all citizens to join in denouncing the production of weapons of mass destruction and work toward their elimination. Signed by Mayor Rob Ford, City of Toronto.
Tobias, I would like to present you with this 1,000 paper cranes, which are from Hiroshima. And I would also like to say that you have been a wonderful supporter of the Hiroshima Day Coalition. She was actually a representative for VANA, Veterans Against Nuclear Arms, in the past. And one of the saddest things that is happening right now is a lot of the people who are in the peace movement are getting older and older, and they find that they don't have the energy to keep going. And Audrey here, she has the energy and she keeps going, and that's wonderful. I would like to encourage you to get your younger people out, your children, your grandchildren, your brothers or sisters, and get them out and get active in the peace movement, because we do need to revitalize the movement and carry it forward. As you've heard, there's a lot of hope, and we need to have the strength to carry it through. Thank you, Audrey. The survivors of the atomic bombs, the Habakusha, are getting older. Their unique experience of surviving the atomic bomb will be lost forever. Many of the survivors dedicated their lives to the abolition of nuclear weapons, compelled to act so no one else would suffer their pain. We must learn from their experiences. If you visit the ICAN website, which is the International Campaign to Abolish Nuclear Weapons, you will see testimony of Habakusha, including that of our next speaker, Setsuko Thurlow. It documents her experience as a witness and a survivor of the atomic bomb, so her story will not be forgotten. Setsuko Thurlow survived the atomic bombing of Hiroshima on August 6, 1945. She is an internationally known peace activist, actively campaigning around the world for nuclear disarmament, and she is also a member of the Hiroshima Day Coalition and a member of the Order of Canada. She attended the Humanitarian Consequences of Nuclear Weapons Conference in Narret and will attend the coming conference in Vienna. Ms. Thurlow is a wonderful representative of the Hiroshima Day Coalition, and also she is a wonderful representative for Canada as she promotes peace and nuclear disarmament around the world. Ms. Thurlow will now speak and present the City of Hiroshima's Peace Proclamation, followed by a minute of silence.
Before I have the pleasure of reading the peace proclamation from the mayor of Hiroshima, Mr. Matsui, I would like to explain briefly how it is prepared. For the mayor of Hiroshima, the observance of annual memorial ceremony of the atomic bombing is perhaps the most important event of the year, with attendance of about 50,000 survivors, citizens, and national leaders, including the Prime Minister, foreign dignitaries, and special guests such as Mr. Ban Ki-moon, Secretary General of the United Nations. When Mr. Matsui became the mayor 4 years ago, he made it clear he wanted lots of input from the survivors, Hibakuchas, to make his mandated peace proclamation genuinely human rather than the survey of international politics or a theoretical abstraction of nuclear weapons. He urged the aging survivors to write their memories, testimonies of their experiences, and let him use some of them for his proclamation. Lo and behold, soon after that, over 60 testimonies flooded his office. He couldn't read it alone. He appointed several citizens, including the survivors, to help read and analyze their testimonies. Those were the testimonies written by those whose pain had been so deeply buried and for so long after their trauma. This collaboration of mayor and citizens have been a wonderful, it has been playing a catalytic role for the healing of long-silenced aging survivors. Now I want you to look at those yellow banners. I have a word to say about this. These contain 351 names of my schoolmates in grade 7 and grade 8 who perished in the bombing of Hiroshima. Whenever I speak about Hiroshima, I take this with me and use this to emphasize the humanitarian impact and consequences of nuclear weapon. And those four Chinese characters make one name. And I point out to the audience that each and every name here represent a real human beings with youth, liveliness, intelligence, and innocence who was wiped away from the face of this planet by one stroke of an indiscriminate, inhumane, illegal, and immoral weapon of mass destruction. Now let me read Mayor's proclamation, and this is edited because of the time. Summer 69 years later, the burning sun takes us back to that day, August 6, 1945. A single atomic bomb renders Hiroshima a burned plain. From infants to the elderly, tens of thousands of innocent civilians lose their lives in a single day. By the end of that year, 140,000 have died. To avoid forgetting that sacred sacrifice and to prevent the repetition of that tragedy, please listen to the voices of the survivors. Approximately 6,000 young boys and girls died removing buildings for fire lanes. One who was 12 years old, junior high student at that time, said, "Even now, I carry the scars of war and that atomic bomb on my body and in my heart. Nearly all my classmates were killed instantly. My heart is tortured by guilt when I think how badly they wanted to live and that I was the only one who did. Having somehow survived, Hibakusha still suffer from severe physical and emotional wounds. Immediately after the bombing, a six-year-old first grader hovered on the border between life and death. Later, she lived a continual fearful struggle with radiation after effects. She speaks out now because I don't want any young people to go through that experience. After an experience with non-Japanese war victim, she decided to convey the importance of young people making friends around the world and unceasing efforts to build not the culture of war, but the culture of peace. The absolute evil that robbed the children of loving families and dreams of future, plunging their lives into turmoil, is not susceptible to threats and counter threats, killing and being killed. Military force just give rise to new cycles of hatred. To eliminate the evil, we must transcend nationality, race, religion, and other differences, value person-to-person relationships, and build a world that allows forward-looking dialogue. Hiroshima asks everyone throughout the world to accept this wish of Hibakusha, the survivors, and walk with them the path to nuclear weapon abolition and world peace. Each one of us will help determine the future of the human family. Please put yourself in the place of the Hibakusha. Imagine their experience, including that day from the depth of hell, actually happening to you or someone in your family. To make sure that the tragedies of Hiroshima and Nagasaki never happens a third time, let's all communicate, think, and act together for the Hibakusha, with the Hibakusha, for the peaceful world without nuclear weapons and without war. We will do our best. Mayors for Peace, now with over 6,200 member cities, will work through lead cities representing us in their part of the world, and in conjunction with the non-governmental organizations and the United Nations to disseminate the facts of the bombings and stressing the humanitarian consequences of nuclear weapons and seeking to outlaw them. We will help strengthen international public demand for the start of negotiation on a nuclear weapons convention with the goal of total abolition by 2020. Japan is the only A-bombed nation. precisely because our security situation is increasingly severe. Our government should accept the full weight of the fact that we have avoided war for 69 years thanks to the noble pacifism of Japanese Constitution. We must continue. Thank you. We must continue as a nation of peace in both word and deed, working with other countries toward the nuclear security to new security system. Looking towards next year's Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty Review Conference, Japan should bridge between the nuclear weapon and non-nuclear weapon states to strengthen the non-proliferation treaty regime. Here and now, we offer a heartfelt consolation to the souls of those sacrificed to the atomic bombing. We pledge to join forces with the people of the world over seeking the abolition of the absolute evil, nuclear weapons, and the realization of lasting world peace. August 6, 2014, Matsui Kazumi, Mayor, City of Hiroshima. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Setsuko Thurlow, for that impassioned speech and delivering the Hiroshima Day Peace Proclamation. In Toronto, with the Hiroshima Day Coalition, we get a little bit spoiled because we're able to see Setsuko every month at our meetings and have her here at the events. But she's actually quite in demand around the world as a peace activist. And I understand that she's already booked for the 70th anniversary in Hiroshima. So we will miss her next year, but we appreciate every day, every Hiroshima Day that she's able to attend with us. Next we have the Japanese Gospel Church Choir, and I will ask them to set up while I... Thank you, whoever said that. So, in remembering the people who died in the atomic bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, I would ask that we all join in a minute of silence. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. The Hiroshima Day Coalition has a poster display at City Hall in the Rotunda with photos and artwork depicting the devastation of the atomic bombs. It's a very powerful and emotional exhibit, and I urge you all to visit the City Hall Rotunda. It will be on display until August 10th. Thank you. Baptist Gospel Church Choir of Toronto and Pastor Kevin Uita for performing today. Please accept this gift of 1,000 paper cranes. And I will put it around your neck because that actually looks pretty good. And please display those paper cranes in public. Let people see them and understand how important peace is and what you've brought here today. Thank you. I would like to now introduce our keynote speaker today, Cesar Jaramillo. He is a program officer at the Waterloo-based Project Plowshares, where he manages the organization's nuclear disarmament program. He has written and lectured on the imperative of nuclear disarmament and on the shortcomings and double standards permeating the global nuclear disarmament and non-proliferation regime. Mr. Jaramillo was in Oslo and in Nayarit, respectively, for the first and second international conferences on the humanitarian impact of nuclear weapons. He plans to attend the third in the series to be hosted by the Austrian government in Vienna on December 8th and 9th this year. We are honored to have Mr. Jaramillo address us today. Mr. Jaramillo.
It is summer because we stand here to remember that dreadful month of August, already 69 years ago, when death, utter destruction, and incalculable human suffering fell upon the men, women, and children of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Many died instantly, others in the months that followed. Farmers and teachers, singers and poets, sons and daughters, old and young. The total number of those killed is estimated to be up to 250,000 people. Yet some survived. The brave Hibakusha, who have since offered firsthand living testimony of the utter devastation caused by nuclear weapons and the long-lasting physical and emotional scars that they still must bear. So yes, this is a grim anniversary. It is a sad reminder that humankind has devised a means to destroy itself, voluntarily. But it is also a day of hope, because the push for a ban on nuclear weapons is growing with every passing day, in intensity, in resolve, in effectiveness, in persistence, in numbers. People all over the world are working tirelessly and diligently to make sure that the world never again witnesses the horrors of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. But how do we go about preventing such a tragedy? The end game to nuclear disarmament is actually remarkably straightforward. There must be a global legal ban on the development, possession, testing, and use of nuclear weapons. There is no other way to rid the world of the most destructive weapon system ever made. Regrettably, more than four decades after the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty came into force, and nearly seven decades after the devastation of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, the states that rely on the purported benefits of nuclear weapons call a ban on these instruments of mass destruction premature. Yes, premature. The international community has allowed this issue to drift endlessly without resolution, despite overwhelming evidence that nuclear weapons lack any legal, political, military, or moral justification. The case has been made from several disciplines, repeatedly and convincingly, that any perceived benefits of nuclear weapons possession are based on flawed assumptions, and in any case, are far outweighed by the threat posed by these weapons to civilization as we know it. The notion that the primary problem of nuclear weapons is the risk of their proliferation and not their very existence cannot be further perpetuated. To be absolutely clear, the main problem with the existence of nuclear weapons is the existence of nuclear weapons. Proliferation concerns are important, of course, but they will never be fully allayed unless the responsibility to disarm is taken seriously by states with nuclear weapons. Furthermore, the discriminatory nature of the global nuclear disarmament and non-proliferation regime is completely untenable. Just consider the lopsided logic by which the very states that have developed, stockpiled, tested, and used nuclear weapons deem themselves fit to chastise others on the risk of proliferation. The moral high ground claimed by states with nuclear weapons is built upon an extremely weak and inherently unjust foundation. But demands for a ban are mounting. Calls come from a growing number of scientists, legal scholars, mayors and parliamentarians, active and retired diplomats, statesmen, regular citizens, from both nuclear and non-nuclear weapon states. The frustration is palpable among those that are increasingly vocal about the failure of nuclear weapon states to meet their disarmament obligations and continue to hold the world hostage to their intransigence. The combined nuclear arsenals of these states is more than 16,000 warheads. 16,000 warheads. Several of these are tens of times more powerful than the ones that devastated Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And as many as 5,000 are on high alert status, ready to be launched within minutes. The risk of deliberate use of nuclear weapons is compounded by the concomitant risks of accidental or unintended use. So what is being done by nuclear disarmament advocates? A series of meetings over the past few years have underscored the humanitarian impact of nuclear weapons as a key reason for their unequivocal prohibition. Most recently, in Nayarit, Mexico, the Mexican government hosted official delegations from more than 140 nations, several multilateral organizations, and international civil society representatives at the second conference on the humanitarian impact of nuclear weapons. Like the first, held in Norway last year, it was premised on the belief that the only foolproof way to ensure that humans do not again suffer the devastation caused by nuclear bombs is to completely eliminate this category of weapons altogether. Renewed attention has been given to the catastrophic humanitarian consequences of nuclear weapons and to the impossibility of providing effective emergency relief following their use. Recognition is growing that the use of nuclear weapons would be thoroughly inconsistent with fundamental precepts of international humanitarian law, including key principles governing the legal use of force, such as distinction, precaution, and proportionality. This recognition must lead to the pursuit of an explicit legal prohibition on nuclear weapons, even if at the beginning some or all of the nine states that currently possess them refuse to participate in the process. Later this year, the Austrian government will build on the Nayarit and Oslo conferences with another one in Vienna. The expectation is that this event will go beyond the visceral discussions of the disastrous effects of a nuclear weapons exchange to focus on concrete measures to avoid such an exchange. The difficulties of such a diplomatic undertaking are clear, but nuclear disarmament advocates in and out of government are experiencing a rare ray of optimism. Those of us in Mexico and Norway experience a distinct feeling of history in the making. We are not there yet, but we are reaching a critical tipping point. The recognition of the catastrophic consequences of any nuclear weapons use has created a new sense of urgency for their elimination. Organizations such as the International Committee of the Red Cross and the United Nations Office for the Coordination of Humanitarian Affairs have made it abundantly clear that there could be no effective response capacity in the event of a nuclear weapons exchange. Let me say that again. No effective relief is possible following a nuclear weapons exchange. The sheer scale of the destruction brought about by nuclear weapons not only makes their use thoroughly incompatible with international humanitarian law, but also makes the delivery of humanitarian assistance all but impossible. So you might wonder, in this context, where does Canada stand in this struggle? Unfortunately, our government stands not with the growing number of nations, organizations, and individuals that believe that a ban on nuclear weapons is long overdue. Instead, the Canadian position is aligned with the few that continue to question the merits of a nuclear weapons ban. But Canada is uniquely positioned to assume a leadership role to rid the world of nuclear weapons. Besides enjoying well-earned international credibility as an honest broker, the country is a member of NATO, a state party to the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, and a member of the G7 and G20. Yet the Canadian government has failed to make nuclear disarmament the top foreign policy priority, when it most definitely should. And such a stand would have wide public support. Civil society organizations, former diplomats, government officials, more than 750 recipients of the Order of Canada, the highest distinction in the land, are urging the Canadian government to support United Nations resolutions calling for formal negotiations toward a nuclear weapons convention. Polls indicate that more than 88% of Canadians support a legal agreement to eliminate nuclear weapons. Even Parliament is on board. In 2010, a unanimous motion by the House and Senate urged the Canadian government, quote, to engage in negotiations for a nuclear weapons convention as proposed by the United Nations Secretary General, and to deploy a major worldwide Canadian diplomatic initiative in support of preventing nuclear proliferation and increasing the rate of nuclear disarmament, a multi-party resolution. But it fell on deaf ears. Last year, during the second preparatory committee of the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, which I had the opportunity to attend, more than 80 nations endorsed a joint statement focusing on the devastating humanitarian impact of nuclear weapons. Canada was not one of them. Later, in October, more than 120 nations endorsed a similar statement on the humanitarian impact of nuclear weapons at the United Nations General Assembly First Committee on Disarmament and International Security. Again, not Canada. Regrettably, Canada seems to be missing the boat on the growing international tide to finally rid the world of the most destructive type of weapons of mass destruction. The humanitarian initiative was never focused on merely recognizing the impact of nuclear weapons, but on drawing out the policy implications that follow from such a recognition. The basic case for nuclear abolition is remarkably simple. If the consequences of nuclear weapons use are unacceptable, and there is a clear and present danger that these weapons may be used by accident, miscalculation, or design, then they must be eliminated. The process to establish a legal ban on nuclear weapons constitutes a necessary step forward for humanity. It will be rooted on the widespread rejection of the continued existence of nuclear weapons and on a full recognition of the catastrophic humanitarian consequences of any use. From this perspective, the use of nuclear weapons is unacceptable, and the goal of their complete elimination is not negotiable. This process will be complex, and the road to an actual nuclear weapons convention that eliminates nuclear weapons will have obstacles. But this is all the more reasons to start laying the groundwork for a nuclear weapons convention now, before the accidental or deliberate detonation of a nuclear weapon by a state or a non-state actor reminds the world of just how urgent this matter is. The calls to address the fundamental injustices underpinning the global nuclear disarmament regime are getting louder and more persistent. It is high time that the international community listen to the collective wisdom of the growing number of individuals demanding the abolition of these weapons. An engaged civil society will continue to urge progress and to scrutinize results. And decision makers will be increasingly held accountable by their constituents for their failure to act, as they should be. Let me finish with a passage by the late author and Nobel Prize laureate Gabriel Garcia Marquez. And I quote, "The nuclear arms race runs against intelligence, and not just against human intelligence, but also against the intelligence of nature, whose purpose manages to escape even the wise clairvoyance of poetry itself."
Thank you.
Thank you to the Kudo Traditional Japanese Drummers. Once again, a wonderful performance, and thank you. Every year you have been great support for our August 6th or August 9th ceremonies. A little bit different this year. We're going to try to incorporate it all together. So we are going to invite our harpist, Suzanne Glasser, up on stage again, and she will play the harp. And what we would like all of you to do is to go over the tables and get a lantern and take it to the reflecting pool while the harpist is playing. We will have Hiroshima Day members at the reflecting pool with lighters to help light the lamps, the lanterns. And we will have Pastor Haru Saito of the Japanese Gospel Church of Toronto. And once we're all there with our lanterns lighted, Pastor Saito will give a closing prayer. I will just introduce Pastor Saito now so that we can use that time to reflect and not have to worry about me talking. Pastor Haru Saito has been with the Japanese Gospel Church of Toronto since 2004. He is a graduate of Hokkei Gakuin University of Japan, McGill University in Montreal, and Jesus to Japan Seminary in Tokyo. So we will incorporate the final prayer with the lantern ceremony, and I hope you can all stay for the lantern ceremony because it is truly a reflective, calming, and spiritual time when you can think about the people who lost their lives in the atomic bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki and see the flames flicker while they float across the water. So, Pastor Saito, we will meet you by the reflecting pool. The people in our audience here, thank you very much on the behalf of the Hiroshima Day Coalition for attending today. We appreciate every single one of you attending today and hope you'll be back next year on August 6th or August 9th, hopefully in the Peace Garden. And I now ask Ms. Glasser to play once again. Thank you.
I'll send her back. 聖書には次のように書かれています。そういうわけで、今日ちょうど一人の人によって罪が世界に入り、罪によって死が入り、こうして死が全人類に広がったのと同様に、それというのも人類が罪を犯したからです。The Bible says,Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, and in this way death came to all men, because all sin. 祈りましょう。Let's pray.天のお父さん、Father in heaven, 素晴らしいあなたの皆をおめでとうございます。Hallow be thy name. 今晩私たちはこの世界で唯一の原子爆弾の被災地である広島と長崎を覚えるためにこのところに集められました。We are gathered in order to remember the only cities in the world that suffered from a Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Hiroshima and Nagasaki において は 一瞬のうちに街が破壊され、数多くの人々が犠牲になりました。あと Hiroshima and Nagasaki, the cities were completely destroyed and many people died and suffered at loss. これは私たちの罪によるものです。 This is caused by our sin. どうぞ私たちの罪をお許しください。 Please forgive our sins. その罪を許すために創造主なるあなたは御子イエス・キリストを2000年前にこの地上に送ってくださいました。 In order to forgive our sins, you, as our Creator God, send us your...
Oh, there's a bug on there.
There.
Here we go. Sorry. No, wait.
Thank you. But at least it's on the wall.
I'm going to go to the hospital.